In 1815, a year after the end of the War of 1812 in America, Napoleon escaped his exile and returned to Paris.
Just as the brothers appeared to be losing the peace, Bonaparte's Hundred Days plunged Europe back into war, restoring the financial conditions in which the Rothschilds had hitherto thrived. This time, not only Russia and Prussia, but the previously aloof Austrians found they had little option but to accept payment from the Rothschilds, as did a gaggle of other states, including Saxony, Baden, Württemberg, Bavaria, Saxe-Weimar, Hesse, Denmark, and Sardinia. Altogether, Harris's account with Nathan in 1815 amounted to £9,789,778. In this, the Rothschilds had invaluable accomplices in the Allied powers themselves, who naturally wished to pocket as much as they could before peace was signed and the subsidies ceased. As their father had taught them, the brothers were always careful to make their terms attractive not only to governments, but also to the individual officials with whom they were negotiating. That Nathan profited from the dramatic events of 1815 is central to Rothschild mythology. By obtaining the first news of Napoleon's defeat at Waterloo, before even the government itself, Nathan was able to make a huge sum of money on the stock exchange.
This is the Waterloo battlefield, about 200 miles northeast of Paris, in what today is Belgium. Here, Napoleon suffered his final defeat, but not before thousands of French and Englishmen gave their lives on a steamy summer day in July of 1815. The outcome was certainly in doubt. In fact, had Napoleon attacked a few hours earlier, he would probably have won the battle. Rothschild stationed a trusted agent, a man named Rothworth, on the north side of the battlefield, closer to the English Channel.
Once the battle had been decided, Rothworth took off for the Channel.
He delivered the news to Nathan Rothschild a full 24 hours before Wellington's own courier.
If Wellington had been defeated and Napoleon was loose on the continent again, Britain's financial situation would become grave indeed.
You backed the wrong horse this time.
Rothschild, you've lost your luck.
Sir.
Look at Rothschild. You'd think he was selling apples instead of government bonds.
Now 53.
All right. I'll keep on selling till I tell you to stop.
You're creating something like a panic on the exchange, sir.
I know.
Other nervous investors saw that Rothschild was selling. It could only mean one thing. Napoleon must have won, Wellington must have lost. The market plummeted. Soon everyone was selling their consols, their British government bonds, and prices dropped sharply. But then, Rothschild started secretly buying up the consols through his agents for only a fraction of their worth hours before.
Bye. Yes, bye. Have you had any news? What do you think about this rumor?
I don't listen to rumors, Mr. Baring.
You hear what they say? Wellington defeated. You might tell me what you're going to do.
I have no objection to all London, man.
What's even more interesting about this story is that some authors claim that the day after the Battle of Waterloo, in a matter of hours, Nathan Rothschild came to dominate not only the bond market, but the Bank of England as well. Whether or not the Rothschild family seized control of the Bank of England, the first privately owned central bank in a major European nation and the wealthiest, one thing is certain. By the mid-1800s, the Rothschilds were the richest family in the world, bar none. They dominated the new government bond markets and branched into other banks and industrial concerns.
Like France and Britain, the Central and East European states emerged from the war with dire financial problems which could be addressed only with the assistance of foreign capital. As Disraeli later put it in his novel, Coningsby, after the exhaustion of a war of 25 years, Europe must require capital to carry on peace. France wanted some, Austria more, Prussia a little, Russia a few million. Moreover, the policy of the Holy Alliance was bound to create additional financial needs from which the Rothschilds could also profit. For the principal aim of the alliance was to avert a recurrence of the revolutionary epidemic which had caused such upheaval in Europe between 1789 and 1815, if necessary, by military intervention. That implied further expenditure. The Rothschilds were notoriously the chief ally of the Holy Alliance. To the German writer Ludwig Berna, they were the nation's worst enemies. They have done more than any to undermine the foundations of freedom, and it is unquestionable that most of the peoples of Europe would by this time be in full possession of liberty if such men as Rothschild did not lend the autocrats the support of their capital. Moreover, the Rothschilds were also, as Berna said, lending money to establish Greece as an independent monarchy, which had been another liberal goal of the 1820s. Indeed, they even appeared to be in a position to influence the decision as to which prince would become the new Greek king. It therefore made more sense to argue that the Rothschilds were beginning to supplant rather than merely shore up the European monarchies. The first major post-war loan which the brothers succeeded in making was to Prussia, which had ended the Napoleonic period with a debt burden of around 188 million thaler and continued to run large deficits in 1815, 1816, and 1817. The size of the floating debt reached 20 million thaler by the autumn, and the government began to contemplate raising a loan in London. Banking, the third Lord Rothschild once remarked, consists essentially of facilitating the movement of money from point A, where it is, to point B, where it is needed. All banks have histories, though not all have their histories researched and written. Only the Rothschilds, however, have a mythology. The world's bankers. The Rothschilds are the wonders of modern banking. We see the descendants of Judah, after a persecution of 2,000 years, peering above kings, rising higher than emperors, and holding a whole continent in the hollow of their hands. The Rothschilds govern a Christian world. Not a cabinet moves without their advice. They stretch their hand with equal ease from Petersburg to Vienna, from Vienna to Paris, from Paris to London, from London to Washington. Baron Rothschild, the head of the house, is the true king of Judah, the prince of the captivity, the Messiah so long looked for by this extraordinary people. He holds the keys of peace or war, blessing or cursing. They are the brokers and counselors of the kings of Europe and of the republican chiefs of America. What more can they desire? Niles Weekly Register, 1835-36. Whatever its significance for Prussian politics, the 1818 Prussian loan was without question a watershed in the history of the European capital market, as contemporaries came to recognize. Firstly, the loan was not to be in thaler, but in sterling, with the interest payable, half yearly, not in Berlin, but in London. Secondly, there was to be a British-style sinking fund to ensure the amortization of the loan. This deliberate Anglicization of a foreign loan was a new departure for the international capital market. Now it was much easier to invest in foreign funds, and the fact that throughout the century all foreign government bonds paid higher yields than British consols meant that people did. The Times did not exaggerate when it later described Nathan as the first introducer of foreign loans into Britain. Moreover, the loan was issued not just in London, but also in Frankfurt, Berlin, Hamburg, Amsterdam, and Vienna. In other words, it represented a major step towards the creation of a completely international bond market. In stipulating these conditions, Nathan not only succeeded in making the Prussian loan attractive to British and continental investors, he also established a model for such international bond issues, which would swiftly become standard. In his book, On the Traffic in State Bonds, 1825, the German legal expert Johann Heinrich Bender identified this as one of the Rothschilds' principal contributions to modern economic development. Any owner of government bonds can collect the interest at his convenience in several different places without any effort. Henceforth, an investor could receive the interest on Austrian Metallic, Neapolitan Rond, or any other Rothschild-issued bonds from any of the Rothschild houses. Although the terms of the loan were heavily criticized in Berlin, not least by the bankers there, Humboldt and Rother were impressed. Rother went further. The Rothschild in this country has an incredible influence upon all financial affairs here in London. It is widely stated, and is indeed close to the truth, that he entirely regulates the rate of exchange in the city. His power as a banker is enormous. In an unpublished passage of The Baths of Lucca, Heine sought to analyze the nature of the Rothschild's power more precisely. Here he acknowledges that in the short term it served to shore up the reactionary regimes. Revolutions are generally triggered off by deficiency of money. By preventing such deficiencies, the Rothschild system may serve to preserve peace in Europe. This system, or rather, Nathan Rothschild, its inventor, is still providing firm foundations for such peace. It does not inhibit one state from making war on another exactly as before, but it does make it difficult for the people to overthrow established authority. Religion is no longer able to guarantee the governments that the people will remain peaceful. The Rothschild system of loans can perform the task much better. It possesses the moral force or power which religion has lost. It can act as a surrogate for religion. Indeed, it is a new religion. When the old religion finally goes under, it will provide substitutes for its practical blessings. Strangely enough, it is once again the Jews who invented this new religion. As early as 1828, Prince Hugler Muskau referred to Rothschild, without whom no power in Europe today seems able to make war. In a multipolar world in which five powers with distinct interests sought to resolve international crises without resorting to war, the Rothschilds acted not so much to ensure peace as to underwrite it once it had been made. The case was put in a more sophisticated form by the left-leaning liberal J.A. Hobson, author of the classic Imperialism, A Study, 1902. Like many radical writers of the period, Hobson regarded the Boer War as having been engineered by a small group of international financiers, chiefly German in origin and Jewish in race. The Rothschilds, in his view, were central to this group. Does anyone seriously suppose, he asked in Imperialism, that a great war could be undertaken by any European state or any great state loan subscribed if the House of Rothschild and its connections set their face against it? Scherb had made much the same point from a German nationalist perspective in his History. The House of Rothschild has arisen from the quarrels between states, has become great and mighty from wars, and the misfortune of states and peoples has been its fortune. English examples can also be found. In refusing Gladstone's request to make Lionel de